those of you in the audience and those viewing the webcast online. We appreciate you taking the time out of your day to join us. I'd like to take a moment to introduce OHFA staff this morning from left to right. We have Matt Wooten, our multifamily lending manager, Maya Beatty, our program and policy manager, Karen Banyai, our operations manager, Daryl Davis, one of our housing tax credit analysts, Kathy Hottinger, one of our 9% analysts, Sam McCoskey, and John McKay, also 9% analysts. In the back, we have Kevin Clark, our operations manager. We have Belinda Lyon, our graduate intern. We have Mark Schlutz, our architect. And we have Christine Bennett, who is our training and operations manager in our program compliance division. Did I miss anybody at the top? And Michelle Newell, who was greeting you as you came in this morning. So, wanted to give you some brief updates about what's going on in our office. First and foremost, our 2015 final applications deadline is coming up on Friday, September 25th. So we know many of you are working hard to get those finalized and ready for submission if you haven't already turned them in. We just wrapped up our 2015 next steps and debrief meetings with development partners, those that were both successful and unsuccessful in the 15 round, and those conversations went very well. Our most recent 4% non-competitive tax credit window closed last Friday, the 11th, and we received two applications. On the gap financing side, we received five applications as part of our housing development gap financing round. Staff is reviewing those applications and we'll be announcing those awards next Wednesday, September 23rd. Our bond gap financing program deadline comes up on October 1st. We have approximately $5.5 million in BGF funds available for 4% tax credit projects that are seeking multifamily bonds. Along with those, we have $15 million in housing development loans available for BGF applicants. The maximum HDL request is $2 million in that round. And the housing development loan application does need to be included as part of your BGF application. There's a tab in our AFA for that. Before I cover the current office structure and functions, I'd be remiss if I didn't mention that there's a conspicuous absence on the stage today, and that is our former director, Andrew Bailey, has moved on. We certainly appreciate the leadership that he provided both PP&D and OHFA and wish him the best as he moves forward. I can tell you, related to the director position, that position has not been filled, and it will take a bit of time to get that done. We're optimistic that will be filled sometime this fall or early winter. With that being said, we have a terrific, hardworking staff and great management team, so I'll cover the current office structure so that if you're not intimately familiar with our office, you'll know who to reach out to for what. We have five divisions. We have our operations, business, portfolio, multifamily lending, and program and policy divisions. Our operations division is led by Karen Banyai, and these are her project analysts, and Mark Schlutz, our architect, are a part of her team. She's responsible for reviewing all the applications for our competitive and non-competitive programs. This really includes all of our programs, 9% and 4% credits, our bond gap financing program, our HEGF program, and our capital investments program. Then we have our business division, which I head. We have project analysts, our field staff, and our administrative professional. This is kind of office logistics and day-to-day office functions. Also oversee project administration, so everything from awarding of credits to placed in service. So that includes construction monitoring, processing of 8609s and draws, and really the transition to our Office of Program Compliance. Our portfolio division is led by Kevin Clark, who's responsible for overseeing project issues that arise after projects have been placed into service, working in conjunction closely with our Office of Program Compliance. He also oversees all of our office data and oversees some of our special programs like the Capital Funding to End Homelessness Initiative. Our multifamily lending division, our newest division, is led by Matt Wooten, who's responsible for overseeing and evaluating requests for multifamily loans to support affordable housing development. And then last but not least, our program and policy division is led by Maya Beatty, who has planners and our policy analyst intern. She helps identify and set housing policy through collaboration with our partners and stakeholders, and is responsible for overseeing the design of all funding programs in the office, including the QAP that we're going to discuss today. And she assists our other divisions implementing programs and creating applications and review tools. And let's see, on the 2016 front, just to circle back, our 2016-17 QAP was approved by the OHFA board in June, so we're excited to be rolling out our first two-year qualified allocation plan in our agency's history. It's really the culmination of a long process involving public hearings, public forums, focus groups, and our first ever policy summit led by Maya Beatty. So thank you again for your participation in that process. We're excited to continue our partnership with you as we kick off the 2016 round with this training. Just wanted to remind folks really quickly that we're offering the opportunity for development teams to meet with our staff as you're putting your finishing touches on your applications in the form of a one-hour in-person pre-application meeting. These just need to be scheduled by December 4th. They can happen before or after that, but they can be scheduled by sending an email to the 2016 QAP mailbox or directly to Karen Banyai or myself. And with that, I'll turn it over to Maya Beatty, our program and policy manager, to discuss the agenda and logistics for today. But thanks again for coming and for your commitment to providing affordable housing to Ohioans.
What we've done with the agenda is attempt to sort of concentrate all of the competitive application material in the morning portion of the agenda. So we'll begin by talking about competitive application limits, experience and capacity reviews. We'll talk briefly about requests for exceptions and some of the things we're looking for as we process those. But the majority of our morning will be spent discussing the allocation pools and competitive scoring criteria. We'll also touch briefly on our scoring and underwriting processes and tools. Before we break for lunch at around noon, we will have a Q&A. As you entered the room, you probably saw on the registration table some cards where you can write questions. There's also a table in the back of the room where index cards and markers are provided. And if you would like to stand up and offer a question or remark, you're free to do so. But if you're not comfortable doing that, we have provided the index cards so that we can address questions during the three Q&A segments. Webinar attendees, if you could send your questions to our attention by emailing the 2016 QAP mailbox, that will allow us to process your questions during these Q&A segments as well. After lunch, we will reconvene to discuss some of the post-allocation requirements, but also design standards and plan reviews. We'll then move into construction monitoring, compliance monitoring, and we'll spend some time briefly talking on state initiatives, including the Section 811 program and the 18% rental subsidy pilot with the Ohio Department of Medicaid. Those are points that are reflected in competitive scoring. We'll end our day with a demonstration and some information on our interactive tools that are associated with the 9% round, including DevCo. And as you all know, there are two new mapping tools that were released in conjunction with the 2016 and 17 QAP. So we'll be providing a demonstration of those tools as well. We'll end the day with some final questions and answers. And we hope to have you out of here on or before 5 p.m.
Good morning. There is a rather detailed agenda which is included in the qualified allocation plan. I'm not going to go over that, but there are some dates that are coming up prior to and concurrent with the application that I do want to make sure you're aware of. This year, you're going to have to certify a CHOTO participant early in the process. Now, and that's due to OHFA by October 16th. That process will only identify those applicants that are CHOTO applicants that meet the minimum requirements established by HUD. It does not guarantee that you'll be considered a CHOTO in the application that is submitted to the agency. When we get the applications, we will ensure, the housing credit staff and myself will ensure, that the CHOTO is, in fact, leading the development team with respect to the given application and does qualify as a CHOTO not only for points but for the home resources. As Kellen mentioned, we are going to set up meetings with development teams that wish to meet with us in advance, go over questions, clarify information. And the last date you can request a meeting is December 4th. Now, the meeting may take place after that, but after December 4th, we will not be scheduling any new meetings. The meetings will take place about an hour, and as Kellen mentioned, you can send it to the QAP mailbox, to his attention or to mine. With that request, you must include an agenda of items you wish to discuss, as well as who's going to be joining you in the meeting from your staff. It will help us identify who needs to participate in the meeting on our side, as well as find an appropriate space so we can all meet comfortably and we're not getting a little bit too comfortable and too cozy with one another. We will set established times for these, and we'll be doing the meetings Tuesdays, Wednesdays, and Thursdays. They'll start mid-November. You can request the meeting at any time. And so when you request a meeting, we will let you know what available time slots we have to meet with you, and you can select among those times. It will be based on first come, first serve. I would strongly recommend that you identify as many areas that you wish to discuss as possible, because if there's a significant demand, OHFA will limit development teams to one meeting. So just make sure you're aware that you know what you need to discuss. Now, as it gets closer to the end of time frame, meaning closer to December 4th, if you believe a second meeting is necessary, you can certainly feel free to reach out to us and we'll let you know if time permits that we have an available slot for you to meet with us again. January 8th, that's the deadline by which you have to have your market studies commissioned. You don't need to do anything with OHFA. Just go ahead about your business and commission your study. OHFA will contact all of those preferred market study providers identified on our website, and we will ask them to provide information about who's already commissioned their market study. We usually give them about a week to collect all the data and put it in a format that we can easily merge together into a master file. So you don't need to do anything. Just understand that that's the deadline, and shortly after that, we will be reaching out to the providers to identify who's been commissioned. At that same time, we also have to have exception requests submitted. I'll go into more detail about that later, but I just wanted to let you know the deadline for that is January 8th. Of course, February 18th, the proposal applications are actually due at OHFA. They have to be here by the end of business that day. And then the good news is don't even worry about DevCo right now. You have 2 weeks after the applications are submitted to OHFA, and by that I mean the hard copies, and to get that information into DevCo. So the deadline to have that complete is March 3rd. Both Kevin Clark and Kellen Craig will be available to assist you should you have questions as you work through that process. And then on a regular basis, we will be posting frequently asked questions. Don't be surprised during this meeting if we're not able to answer a question. We try to think up as many, try to address as many issues as we can in this training. But you guys are already working on projects and probably will have questions that we've not thought of. In that event, we'll add that to our frequently asked questions and provide that information available to everyone on that posting. Also, if we identify a question is very project specific, we reserve the right to answer that individual directly and not post it. And if you want a unique answer that you don't want shared because you believe it may affect your scoring or may release information you don't want to share at this point in time, please let us know. We're sensitive to that, and we do understand. So the next thing I want to talk about is competitive application limits. New this year is we're limiting general partners and developers to 4 applications. If you're a new applicant, you may submit 4 applications, but you're limited to 1 allocation of credits. If you're new to us, you will not be able to apply again until you've successfully completed the first application up through the issuance of 8609s. And when you submit your application, you do have to identify the pool in which you want to compete. It's going to be strategic for you because sometimes you may be able to compete in a different, a variety of pools. But you may not submit 1 application and ask us to consider it in this pool and this pool. You have to select the pool in which you're going to compete. This has changed a bit this year, and it links a lot to not only prior experience we've had in the last 2 years, but as well as the limitations that we've imposed on owners and developers. So we are going to be taking a closer scrutiny in terms of the experience and capacity of the development team. As I mentioned, we've been a little bit less than prohibitive in this aspect in the past, and we're paying for it now. So we're going to be looking at the role the general partner, and the developer are playing in the project. Do you have experience doing that role? If you're the developer, you absolutely must have experience in developing affordable housing. We prefer housing credit experience, either in Ohio or not in Ohio. If you don't, please be prepared and understand that OHFA may require you to enlist the aid of a co-developer. In terms of ownership, we do expect that you'll have experience owning a project. If you've not done housing credits before, we reserve the right to require you to attend program compliance training, and we may ask you to attend it more than once. We will require, most likely, that you attend it at least one session in connection with or along with your management company. Now, with respect to management companies, PP&D does not evaluate that particular member of your development team. We contact program compliance, and they review all of the management entities, and they will contact us with any particular issues or concerns they have. So, and then a lot of the questions we've gotten recently is, I'm actually a consultant in this deal. I'm not really the developer. Does that count against me in terms of my maximum four? You're going to have to answer some questions. First of all, if you've got an owner and an experienced developer, why do you need a consultant? And if you as a consultant are playing the role of a developer, the answer is yes. It will be considered one of your four applications in the round. If you have any doubt, again, that's an opportunity for you to meet with OHFA staff, discuss the roles and responsibilities of each member of the development team, and kind of present to us why you don't think that should be counted against you. Requests for exceptions. They're limited in the qualified allocation plan. You can't request an exception for everything in there. So please pay particular attention. We have an exception request form we'll be putting online that will identify the very specific areas in which you can request an exemption. And I say this every year. Underwriting exceptions, vacancy rate, debt coverage ratio, those will not be evaluated until the application comes in. If you want to send a request in, feel free. I have a template letter that says, we're not going to be evaluating it at this point in time. I'll put your name on it and send it back to you. But that's going to be the answer. So I mean, if you want that, I'll be happy to do it. But you know, you're wasting your time and mine. Well, it's less time for me because I already have the template generated. Supporting documentation is important. Please be clear and concise. You have the narrative you provide within the exception request form itself. And then you're asked to provide supporting documentation. For parking, it might be bus routes or bus schedules available in an urban center. But more is not better. You should not be repeating the information you already put in the document itself. And you don't get extra points for extra pages. A volume is not a competitive criteria. It really isn't. So only provide what you need to provide. Now, there may be a possibility that the documentation you submit is redundant and you can't help it. Then highlight the areas we need to look at in that document. I'm going to ask you to make sure you do a color PDF so we can tell what you've highlighted. But it's easier for us, and we'll be better prepared to give you an accurate answer if you're clear in what you want us to evaluate. Please don't refer to prior requests. Last year, I can't tell you how many I got, was here's your approval for this year, so just approve it this year. Or last year, so you need to approve it this year. No. We grow every year as an agency. We learn things from our projects that are under construction and currently being developed. You need to treat requests as if it's the first time you're submitting it. You can certainly provide documentation you provided last year if it's still relevant, but please don't just send me last year's approval and say we want the same thing this year. The answer is going to be no. You didn't provide the necessary documentation for us to evaluate the request. Any changes or any questions on the information I just provided? I get the easy parts today. Okay, thank you. Oh, yes. The limitation to four applications is for each individual year. So you may submit four applications in 2016. And then 2017, you are again able to submit a different set for new applications, provided you're not a new developer to OHFA.
So before we dive into the specific criteria for the various allocation pools, I just wanted to provide some context about how we arrived at this QAP. You'll see a number of key changes that are reflected in this allocation plan, and we'll review today together. As Kellen mentioned, this is our first two-year plan. It aligns with our agency's strategic plan, goals and objectives. What is the most significant change from previous plans is that we have housing policy pools that each have their own unique scoring criteria and systems. And we have also adjusted our geographic definitions. So with regard to the geographic definitions, there are two distinctions made in the 2016 and 17 allocation plan, and that is between urban and non-urban. The non-urban counties, as shown on the screen here, are shaded in blue with, or I'm sorry, the non-urban counties are shaded in gray and urban in blue. The urban counties represent the largest, most densely populated counties, and each have a population of 250,000 or more. To touch briefly on the housing policy pools, which again we'll go into more detail about each of these, for new unit production, there are four different pools, the first being family housing in urban counties, which has a funding target of $4 million, senior housing in urban counties, which has a funding target of $4.5 million, non-urban housing, which encompasses both family and senior housing, has a funding target of $5 million. And we've received a lot of questions about this, but I just want to make that clear here. Single family infill development is also an urban pool. Our funding target here is $1.5 million. There are two preservation pools, one for HUD rental subsidy, the second for rural asset preservation. For HUD rental subsidy, our funding target is approximately $4 million. This is an urban pool. And for rural asset preservation, which may include HUD or USDA rental subsidies, our funding target is $3 million. As with previous allocation plans, our permanent supportive housing pool has remained, and the funding target here is $4 million statewide. Across all pools, as you'll see, and we'll go into more detail again, there are some common scoring items, including local partnerships, development and preservation priorities, income targeting, financial characteristics, land uses, which encompasses proximity to positive and detrimental land uses, and exceptional development characteristics. We have and will continue to receive a great number of questions in this particular category of scoring, known as exceptional development. It's probably one of the more areas of the QAP where we get frequently asked questions. As Karen mentioned, if we can't answer your questions today, we will jot those down and address them in future issues of the frequently asked questions. But today I'm going to touch briefly on each of the eight criteria and kind of what we're looking for as evidence to show that you're eligible for the points. So just generally speaking about exceptional development, there are a maximum of 10 points that can be earned in this category. However, it's important to understand that in the tie-breaking process for all pools with exception for PSH, the number of criteria met, not necessarily points earned, because the number of criteria met may exceed the 10 points. This will be factored into our tie-breaking process and considerations. Exceptional development points will be awarded to no more than 50% of proposals in each category. So it's important that applicants that are seeking points for any one of the criteria really make their case in the narrative forms and in the supporting documentation to distinguish your proposal within that top tier of applications. In no one category will any partial points be awarded, so it's an all or nothing deal. And again, as I mentioned earlier, PSH developments are exempt from these criteria. The first exceptional development characteristic that I'll touch on is creative design. So what we're really seeking to accomplish with creative design are exceptional developments that show really innovative architecture or design that contributes to greater housing affordability or quality of life for residents. So how we will be evaluating this particular criteria is by evaluation of documentation supporting the valuation or estimate of any cost savings or cost efficiencies that are tied to the creative design features or attributes of your proposal. It's important to note that cost efficiencies or savings need to be well documented in the proposal, whether they relate to development cost, operating costs, or household expenses. Ultimately, our final determination as to which 50% of proposals receive these points will be tied to those proposals that demonstrate the greatest measurable savings. It's also important to note that preliminary plans and specifications submitted at proposal application must show the nature of all features that are being represented in your creative design narrative. And it's also important to note that any features, attributes, or specifications, they must exceed the mandatory requirements of the applicable green standard that the proposal will be seeking certification under. Actually, I'm going to go back for a second and just touch on a couple things. One of the things that we are looking for, as I mentioned, is quantifiable cost savings and efficiencies. So it's important to look at the competitive scoring workbooks in this category because it outlines in greater detail how you might go about really putting together a strong narrative to evidence that your proposal is eligible for these points. Quantifiable savings, as you'll see in the workbook, might be in the area of building performance, sustainability, safety and security, or other attributes that can be defined. But the narrative form will also ask you to identify any non-quantifiable attributes, such as function or aesthetic, that contributes to quality of life. Community investment is a category under exceptional development that's really intended to identify those developments that are being completed in conjunction with local investments that support housing development, economic development, or provision of services to a very specific target area, which in this case is a 2-mile radius that we're looking at. The investments or investment activity represented in the proposal must be funded by a developer or member of the general partnership, which in this case could be an owner or master developer or a local neighborhood organization, again, who is a member of the general partnership. The minimum threshold for consideration in this category of scoring is an investment level of $250,000 or more. One of the questions that we have been receiving is what would count in this category as a demonstrated investment. What we have determined internally is that no previous LIHTC investment, which would include deferred developer fee, would count toward this criterion, but we would consider grants or funds or other resources that are allocated to a recipient and directed to the target area at the recipient's discretion. So that might include things like new market tax credits or local grant funding, et cetera. At proposal application, what we'll want to see is a complete narrative form and a graphic representation or asset map showing the location of all the investment activity that's represented in the proposal. We'll also want to see documentation that shows how you arrived at the value of these investments and the source of the money that was used to pay for them or implement them. Local development priority is something that's sort of carried over from previous allocation plans. However, it is now within our category for exceptional development. It is restricted to urban counties, and as with previous years, what we're looking for as evidence of this criteria is an executed letter that's signed by the appropriate chief administrative officer. Cincinnati, Cleveland, and Columbus will be receiving three priority designations. Akron, Dayton, and Toledo will receive two, and all other municipalities located in an urban county will receive one. We'll talk about it later on when we get to local initiatives, but you should note that local development priority is required if you are going to compete for local initiatives points. With economic development, which is another category under exceptional development, what we are really trying to align with are developments that are working in accordance with goals of local government. What we also want to see are tax incentives provided by a local, regional, or state entity, and commercial market rate housing and other real estate development occurring within a 2-mile radius. Like the other characteristics, we'll want to see a complete narrative form and some sort of representation or map showing the extent and scope of the economic development strategy. We'll also want to see evidence of a commitment from the local government. You'll submit a signed letter that outlines the incentives that are being provided and expresses the required support. And if there's a economic development plan or some other plan that documents the strategy or initiative that covers this target area, we would want to see that in your application as well. And I touched on the last point, but again, the strategy must include commercial, market rate, and other real estate investment. Education and opportunity is really for developments that will provide or enhance educational opportunities for children in grades K through 12 or adults who are pursuing higher learning at a skilled trade or post-secondary institution. At proposal application, we'll want to see a complete narrative form that talks about the initiative or strategy that's being implemented. And furthermore, we'll want to see signed commitment or agreements with the local partners who are going to assist in implementing this strategy or initiative. Any supplemental materials that you can provide would be helpful if they clearly show the history, mission, and experience of the local partners who are assisting with the strategy. It's important, however, when you're submitting supplemental materials, as Karen mentioned, that it's very clear what we need to consider in our evaluation. So if you could highlight or otherwise identify the exact pages that we need to refer to, that would be helpful as we assess your application in this category. As you know, the education and opportunity scoring, the preference criteria, refer to school rankings. So I did just want to keep everyone on the same page and let you know that that information is available from the Ohio Department of Education. As I mentioned, the competitive scoring workbooks are really important in the exceptional development category, and you'll find links to all of the relevant data and information that you need within those scoring workbooks. So please take a look at that when you're considering whether your proposal fits within this category and others. Healthcare, which is restricted to developments that will serve senior households or people who are aged 55 and older, is our attempt to align with align housing with healthcare interventions that reduce costs to federal and state systems and programs, including Medicare and Medicaid. Ultimately, what we're looking for are the greatest quantifiable savings to these systems and programs that we can demonstrate in conjunction with our program. At proposal application, we'll want to see a complete narrative form that outlines whatever the intervention that's being provided is, and we'll also want to see signed commitments or agreements with the local providers. It's also helpful for us to understand where the services will be provided in relation to the actual location of the development. So if you can submit a map or site plan that shows the location of services in relation to relationship to the development, that will be considered in our evaluation. Finally, and perhaps most importantly, one of the things that we are really looking for you to do is to document and support the valuation of your cost savings. One of the things that we will be relying on in our decision as to who gets the points for healthcare or not will be those, again, that can demonstrate quantifiable savings, preferably through demonstrations or pilot initiatives that show real numbers and real outcomes. And then finally, as with some of the categories we talked about previously, it's very helpful for us to understand the history, mission, and experience of the local partners who are assisting with the healthcare interventions or services. So if there are supplemental materials that you can provide, again, highlighted, referenced very clearly, that would be useful and considered in our assessment. Workforce housing is a category that attempts to link employment and affordable housing opportunities within a 5 to 10 mile radius, depending on whether you're sited, your project is sited or located in an urban or non-urban county. Again, with this category, we'll want to see a complete narrative form, sign commitments with the employers or partners who are going to be working in conjunction with the development team, and we'll want to see a map or plan showing the location of all employment opportunities in relation to the proposed development. One of the questions that we've received is, what will we consider? What types of strategies would we consider here? At minimum, we'll want to see that there are some workforce opportunities available to residents. However, if these opportunities can be guaranteed or offered on a preferential basis to residents and in close proximity to the development, as you'll see in the preference criteria listed in the QAP, that will be given greater weight and consideration. There are two pieces of data that the preference criteria refer to, and we'll do a demonstration of the policy map tool later on in the afternoon. So sit tight for that, but you'll want to note here that you'll want to refer to those maps if you are looking to meet the preference criteria. Finally, in exceptional developments, we have a category called local initiatives. And local initiatives is really intended to target large-scale, catalytic developments that are including multiple phases and a considerable number of units. So the minimum criteria in this category for consideration require that the development is recognized as contributing to a community economic development or neighborhood plan. It must provide for a mix of land uses and housing types, including market rate housing, and it must include a minimum of 125 units, 50 units if located in a non-urban county. As I mentioned before, if you are competing in local initiatives and you're located in an urban county, local development priority will be required, and points would not be earned for local development priority in addition to the 3 points that are available for local initiatives. If the project is located in a non-urban county, as you know, we do not require local development priority for non-urban counties. However, we would want to see a letter of support or some expression of support from the local municipality since that this is a local initiative. Finally, and probably most importantly, the development must leverage significant investment, whether through partnership with private and public organizations, local corporations, or other institutions. And these this leverage must account for no less than 25% of total development cost. So it's important that you understand the thresholds that will be required for consideration in local initiatives. It's equally important that applicants and local sponsors weigh the trade-offs with this particular criteria, because applicants who are awarded points for local initiatives will not be able to compete in the 2017 program year. And additionally, the local government providing support will have to forego one priority designation in program year 2017. However, the benefit of local initiatives is that you would be considered for $1 million in program year 2016 and a conditional commitment for up to $1 million in program year 2017, conditional, of course, upon your completion of an updated application in 2017 for the second phase. And I guess I left that point out. Developments that are competing in this category do have to have two phases, hence why we are providing the benefit of a two-year commitment for allocation. I am going to take a seat and we'll do some questions here. I know there's going to be some conversation and discussion, and then we'll move into new unit production. So I think what you're saying is you want to self-score your application based on the number of criteria met. And that is what we want you to do. As Karen mentioned, you will be submitting a competitive workbook for all the areas in the QAP for which you're seeking consideration. However, you need to understand you will only be allowed a maximum of 10 points for exceptional development.
Yeah. Nicole, I'm going to go over that later, but yeah, this year you are allowed to self-score, and it's going to be very helpful to us. But one of the tiebreakers is the number of criteria met, so you do want to make sure that you're providing all the documentation to meet as many of the criteria as you can. So what your question, if you're correct, is that you want to do two phases. You want the consideration for having two phases, but you want the first phase to be a prior phase? No, you would need to have a current phase plus a proposed next phase. So we're not looking backwards, we're looking forwards.
We did have a question from someone participating on the webinar, and we'll have to provide some additional clarity around this in a future FAQ. But the questions are, what qualifies as a healthy housing feature that will exceed enterprise green communities, and what qualifies as advanced energy saving technology that would exceed enterprise green communities requirement? So we'll address those questions. If there's nothing further, I'll turn it over to Daryl Davis, who's going to talk to you about family housing.
Good morning. I'm Daryl Davis, one of the 9% tax credit analysts. Before we get started on the slide, I think everybody should know this has been a lot for the analysts to wrap their heads around as well. So we've been very busy trying to look at how we're going to score things, how we're going to debate things, and that sort of thing. So the QAP is pretty straightforward in what you need to submit. So what I'd like to talk about is a little more detail about exactly what you're going to submit. And I can't reiterate what Karen said enough. Volumes and volumes of information is not what we're looking for. I think the easiest way to make your submission in any given category is a synopsis of what it is you're trying to achieve, excuse me, bullet points outlining the details of what you're trying to achieve, and then you can submit supporting documentation with it being highlighted. I can tell you as an analyst, there's nothing worse than after a project is submitted and it didn't get funded, realizing that if this was submitted differently, if we would have known this information, then the outcome may have been a little different. So how you submit your information is important. What you submit, we have to try to read all of it. So if you give me 150 pages, it's just going to make the process that much more difficult to get through. And you know, so the more simple you can make your submission, the better it is going to be for you. So a brief synopsis of what it is that you're trying to communicate, bullet points outlining the specific details that are important, and then the supporting documentation with what we really need to see highlighted. Now, everything that you submit, somebody at OHFA is probably going to read it. But the easier you make that information available to us, the better it's going to be for your submission. Okay. Who's doing the slides? Oh, I'm doing the slides. All right. Just click it. All right. For the family housing category, funding target, $4 million. The maximum per application is $1 million. This year, family housing only applies to the urban counties. And single family infill developments are not eligible. They have their own pool this year. And from the QAP, you can see the counties that count as urban. I don't need to go too far into that. Family housing is obviously, if you've been in this business for any amount of time, you already know this information. It's not anything not restricted to households age 55 and older, all income eligible households, regardless of children, with a set aside for family housing in areas of opportunity. And Maya talked a little bit about that already. For the competitive scoring, again, pretty straightforward. Exceptional development, there are 10 points available. Local partnerships, 15 points. State development priorities, 20, land uses, 20, financial characteristics, up to 30, income targeting, 10, family housing priorities, 10 points, and then the tiebreakers. For exceptional development, Maya went through most of these. I just want to point out a couple of things here for your community investments and economic development. The amount of investment and proximity to the property are both important. So we will be looking at both of those, the amount and the proximity to the property. Education and opportunity is something I just want to take a quick minute to touch on. The one thing that we know for absolute certain that fights poverty is education. So we're looking for you guys to get a little feel free to get a little creative in this category. You definitely want to document what you're doing. You want to show examples of success. And again, you want to give us a brief synopsis of what it is you're presenting, those bullet points, and then the supporting documentation. But with education and opportunity, there are a lot of things on the table. Post-secondary education, trades, it's all on the table. So feel free to get a little creative. That's what we're looking for this year. The exceptional development categories under local development priorities, just like previous years, Columbus, Cleveland, Cincinnati get 3 priorities, Akron, Dayton, Toledo 2, and all other municipalities in those urban counties get 1. And as Maya went over before, applicants for local initiatives must receive local development priority, although you will not get points for that particular category. And for the family housing priorities, and all of this is outlined pretty well in the QAP production of three-bedroom units is going to be very important this year. Production of four-bedroom units with a preference for voucher holders, and that should be outlined in your affirmative fair housing marketing plan. A preference for senior householders with children, and that should also be outlined in your affirmative fair housing marketing plan. Access to high-performing schools rated B or better. That's going to be a difficult one to achieve, but there is a priority for that this year. And moderate to high areas of opportunity, and the opportunity index is available on the website, and you can get the information that you need there. And the tiebreakers this year will break down to the exceptional development characteristics, as Maya went over, the highest number of family housing priorities, so the more of those priorities you meet, the better, the greatest number of affordable units, and credits from the cap. And that's it for family housing.
Left. My other right. Good morning. I'm Kathy Hottinger, and I'm a 9% analyst. I'm going to talk to you about the senior housing pool. And honestly, it confused me at first, but the senior housing pool is just in the urban areas this year. We'll talk about where other senior projects come in just a minute. The funding target for this pool is $4.5 million. How do I click it back? They normally don't let me operate anything like this, but this is getting... There we go. Okay, now how do I get that off? I have acquired helplessness when it comes to electronic things. There's $4.5 million in this pool, a cap of $1 million per application, and only in the urban areas. The map again showing the urban areas in blue and the rest of the state in gray. The overview for this particular pool is households age 55 and older, independent adults, and we're looking for services to help keep those adults in their homes longer. The competitive scoring, each one of the pools is slightly different in the number of points that you can achieve. With senior housing, you have the exceptional development, local partnerships, state development priorities, land uses, financial characteristics, income targeting, and senior housing priorities, as well as the tiebreakers. Under exceptional development, you can receive points for creative design, and don't just think bricks and sticks. Think of other opportunities to be creative in your development. Community investment, local development priority, and in this pool that would mean getting a letter of priority from the local government, economic development, health care, workforce, and local initiatives. Columbus, Cleveland, and Cincinnati each get three priority designations. That would be for family development or senior. Akron, Dayton, and Toledo, 2, and all other municipalities, 1. If you're applying for local initiative points, you must receive the local development priority. Under the senior housing priorities, again, we're trying to stress aging in place. So communities enabling residents to age in place are going to be hot on our list. At least 25% of the units in the development, but not more than 80% of the units, are two bedrooms, so that if someone needed a caretaker to stay with them, they could. The continuing care model or on-site health care services are in a campus setting, with at least 25% of the units offered on a preferential basis to residents 62 and older. So even though 55 would be the bottom end of the age range, we're looking for 25% of those units to be set aside for 62 and older. That has to be demonstrated in your affirmative marketing plan. We will be reviewing those. It doesn't have to be the final plan when you submit your application, but we do need to see what your outreach would be. And if your community is located in an area where 25% or more of the population is 55 and older, that's a good thing. And if there are no other affordable communities that are age designated in your surrounding area, that would also be beneficial. The tiebreakers would come under exceptional development characteristics. The highest number of senior housing priorities, the greatest number of affordable units that you're providing, and credits from the cap. So in this case, it would be $1 million. If you come in at $750,000, you would score well with that. Then moving on to non-urban, and this is where I was a little bit confused. This category is for families and seniors, but outside of the urban counties. The funding target is $5 million. The maximum per application is $800,000. You have to be located in an area that is outside of an urban community, and it would be for families and for persons aged 55 and older. And again, the map. There is a set aside in this particular pool. So low population counties, and by low population I mean populations of 50,000 or less, and mid-sized counties, which would be populations of 50,000 to 99,000, if your project is in one of those areas, it would move you up just a notch. If we don't fund anything in that set aside, those funds could be distributed to the next highest scoring project in the non-urban housing proposal. And again, under competitive scoring, you have a list of everything that's available to this particular pool. And Maya did make up a really good scoring workbook. Has that been put on the website yet? It's an excellent tool. Please use that. And again, you're going to hear this as a constant theme throughout the morning. Use the OHFA forms. Keep your narratives clear and concise. Highlight anything that you want us to read, because we read an awful lot of material with each application that's submitted. And in non-urban housing, you also have exceptional development, and you have creative design, community investment, economic development, education and opportunity for family projects, or healthcare for the senior projects, workforce and local initiatives. The non-urban housing priorities would be areas impacted by shale drilling, and there is a map for all of those areas. Located in eligible underserved counties, projects that would account for at least 30% of income-restricted housing in the PMA, located in a downtown or central business district, partnering with an Ohio Main Street program. Maya, you did say you were going to go over that at some point.
Just to reiterate here, it's important to take a look at the competitive workbook. It provides a link to the contact of the individual at Heritage Ohio who can provide a letter of support if you are seeking points for this criteria. But that's the extent of what I wanted to say with regard to that.
Okay. It has to be in a non-QCT and in a county showing population growth. The other part of that category would be for senior housing, a development providing a community for independent adults 55 and older, and offering a continuing care model or on-site campus setting, providing flexible housing options, coordinated services and amenities, and that would enable the resident to live in place. Family housing, at least 5% of the affordable units are three bedrooms, and at least 5% of the total affordable units are four bedrooms, and they'll be offered on a preferential basis to current voucher holders on an MHA wait list for a larger unit. Tiebreakers would be exceptional housing development characteristics. The more of those that you can meet, the higher you'll score. The highest number of non-urban housing priorities and credits from the cap. So in this case, it's 800,000 per application. The lower you come underneath that number, the better. And preservation is next.
Hi, I'm Sam McCoskey. I will be presenting the preservation pools. There are two of them. The first is HUD rental subsidy. So the funding target for that is $4 million. The max per application is $1 million, and this is urban counties only with a rental subsidy. And then the second pool is the rural asset pool. The target for that is $3 million. The max is $700,000, and this is non-urban counties, and this includes projects with a USDA subsidy or a HUD subsidy. So don't get thrown off if it is a non-urban county. So any of these gray counties, you will be in the rural asset preservation pool, even if you have a HUD subsidy. And of course, if you have a HUD subsidy in an urban county, you will be in the HUD rental subsidy pool. So within competitive scoring, the projects are eligible to receive 100 points. And there are a few ways to get there, as it's been explained before. So within exceptional development, some of those categories are not eligible for preservation projects. So please be aware of that. Preservation projects can receive points in creative design, community investment, economic development, education and opportunity if they're a family project, healthcare if they're a senior project, or workforce. And then within state preservation priorities, there are location-based priorities and development-based priorities, and that category will be used for a tiebreaker. So the more points you receive for those categories, the better in the tiebreaker situation. The rest are pretty similar to the new units category. And then there are 15 points available for the rental subsidy category. So the HUD rental subsidy is 15 points available, and then the rural asset preservation is also 15 points. And that's broken down between the percentage of units that are subsidized and if they received USDA priority from the Ohio office. For location-based priorities, applications may receive up to 20 points, and 5 points are awarded for each of the following, up to 20 points. And most of these are similar to the new units pool. However, there is the addition of if the project is located close to a transit stop, it can score 5 points, so provide a map showing how close the project is and a schedule of, you know, the bus comes, this amount, et cetera. And then development-based priorities, also 20 points available, 5 points per criteria. And this is similar to past years with preservation or the new units. The only difference is the total development cost of less than $130 per unit, and the request is 25% below the max allowable for the pool. And the tiebreakers for the pool, just like the others, exceptional development characteristics, highest number of state priorities met, greatest number of subsidized units, and then number of credits below the max request. And just for the rural asset preservation pool, the first tiebreaker is having that USDA priority.
Permanent supportive housing. Just want to reiterate, I guess Kathy covered a little bit the scoring worksheets, and I think we put a lot of work this year into putting out exactly what we would be looking for each individual item. So please pay attention to that. We gave all that information to Maya, and I think she did an awesome job making it real pretty and easy to read. So I think it's going to make it easier for you to do your scoring, and it's going to make it a lot easier for us to review the scoring. So definitely pay attention to the scoring workbooks and follow those. I think there's some pretty good guidance there. Permanent supportive housing, funding target $4 million, maximum per application $1 million, and those are divided into the HUD-designated continuums of care and the balance of state continuums of care. The HUD-designated continuums of care covers the urban counties, Summit, Hamilton, Cuyahoga, Franklin, Montgomery, Lucas. And each of those COCs may submit up to two ranked proposals, first place, second place, first choice, second choice. And then the balance of the state, the smaller continuums, Stark, Mahoning, and the rest of the state, those COCs may submit up to two ranked proposals. Minimum of one project will be awarded in that balance of state. If there are no applications, that money will be allocated to the next highest scoring proposal statewide. For permanent supportive housing, commitment for project-based rental subsidy for 50% of the units. Now, that is now a threshold item. So that commitment will need to be in place. So that's something that has caused us some problems in the past, because we get down the line and realize that it wasn't a firm commitment. So please make sure that commitment is in place. For those, the 50% of the units have to have project-based rental subsidy in place to move forward. The majority GP must be a nonprofit with experience developing, owning, and managing permanent supportive housing. So requirements are a little bit different than last year, and as usual, they must have a letter of support from the local continuum. Competitive scoring, real straightforward on PSH. Local partnerships, 25 points. The COC priorities, up to 25 points. Land uses, 20 points. Financial characteristics, another 20 points, and then down to the tiebreakers, which are the project should serve at least 50% chronically homeless, and that is the HUD definition of chronically homeless. So if you're not familiar with that, I mean, obviously, if you're submitting in PSH, I'm sure you're probably familiar with that by now. Medicaid-funded or reimbursable services available to the tenants of your project, and credits from the CAP is the third tiebreaker. And I'll turn it over to John.
Hi, I'm John McKay. I'm going to do the single-family infill pool. So basically, this is going to be new construction only. One of the things we heard back in the policy summit and different feedback from stakeholders was that would rehab be considered, and it's not this time, so I just want to stress that. In terms of the max per application, previously in 14 and 15, since those QAPs were so similar, we didn't do a massive overhaul then. The cap was $1 million. Now it's $750,000, so keep that in mind, that change. In terms of the urban counties as a whole, just in terms of where we've been coming from and where we're going, back in 14, we had 8 urban counties, which are pretty self-explanatory. Then we went down to 6 because of population dynamics in 15. And then for 2016, 2017, what we've included now is Lorain and Butler are the additional counties. So there's 10 total now. So keep that in mind in terms of changes between the years. Also, historically, before I get into the overview, we had two projects funded in 2014, one in 2015. So now in 2016 and 2017, there will be two. In terms of the neighborhood revitalization, when you're talking about the half-mile radius, make sure that you have the centralmost site and use an area map that designates ownership, who it is right now, and any proposed parcels. Obviously, with lease purchase, we find that there's a lot of things that are moving in different pieces and parts. So we understand if some parcels drop out or are going to change from proposal to final and even to carryover for that instance. If that is the case with the legal description, make sure you keep us aware of that in terms of making sure the legal description is as accurate as possible. In terms of the municipal planning department letter, with all the letters, and this rarely happens, but I want to stress it, make sure they're signed. Sometimes they come in and they're not. So that's something that I just want to stress. And make sure it references the product as a whole. In terms of the home ownership strategy, the valuation estimate, I think a lot of people do a really good job with this, but just make sure you detail that out as specific as possible. In terms of supportive services, what we're really looking for is a commitment, so an MOU signed is always preferred. If it gets into the point where someone is hesitant to sign in terms of it being a 15-year commitment, I always recommend to people that you may want to just put renewed annually on the basis of financing being available, so that way you kind of address that. And then if somebody were to drop out, just make sure that that language is in there covering that you would replace that person to make sure that there's no gap in services being provided. And then make sure that you have the right of first refusal. And the basis boost is for 35 points for single-family infill development priorities. In terms of the competitive scoring, we want to make this as complicated as possible. So we have a total of 115 points instead of 100 now. And every pool is a different total. So the one thing I want to highlight is just the exceptional development. Since there's 10 points max, there's six that will apply to the single family infill development pool. And it's on the final slide here. So I want to make sure you're aware of that. Not all eight apply. But you're going to want to make sure, obviously, that you hit as many of those as possible since that's the first tiebreaker. So the regional service providers, a great way to hit this is in terms of documentation to submit, since a lot of this you've seen already is through brochures. You'll get 5 points if you can hit the comprehensive definition, which is up on the slide. In terms of maintenance and home repair and the financial credit counseling, home buyer counseling, all that, make sure that you hit the topics that are covered in those classes. That's always beneficial. And make sure, too, that the brochure actually highlights the population served, the service area itself, that whole laundry list of services they provide. One of the things that's important to keep in mind is that for that additional 5 points, where you're including a bunch of other things like health promotion and job training, you can have multiple service providers. We've gotten that question a little bit where somebody thinks that you just have to have one to hit as many of those as possible, but you can have multiple ones. In terms of the local partners, the 10 points maximum, the nonprofit organization with at least 25% general partner interest, make sure that's reflected in the AFA. If it isn't, that's something that we would ask about, especially in a competitive round. It might be something where obviously there's a lot of things going on. It might fall through the cracks, but I would double check that. In terms of the community outreach plan, just make sure that you have a laundry list of who the residents are that were there, the stakeholders, any feedback, questions, and responses to those then in your application. And with the letter of support, too, from the County Land Bank, just make sure to reference the resources that are going to be used in the project. In terms of the positive land uses, it's linear distance. This was a change from 2014 to 2015, and we've continued that with the linear aspect. And we've broken down the retail services and public facilities to help kind of guide people. Obviously, some of these, especially for single-family infill, are probably more important than others. So, for instance, I would just say the farmer's market and the community gardens and the service supermarket is something that we would be curious about. So if you were to get funded and you didn't have those aspects, that would be something I'd be curious in next steps how those would be addressed moving forward. In terms of the proximity detrimental land uses, again, which is similar from past years, the one thing that I would hit on is just the blight. What's going on around the property? How are you going to address that? What's the plan? Is it government grants? That's something that we'll be curious about in terms of moving forward. The credits per unit did not have any change from past years, so that should look very specific to people. In terms of leverage, and there's one thing I just want to highlight here, because in the QAP, we had the multifamily lending program as eligible for leverage. However, this is contradictory to the guidelines for the multifamily lending program, which is a problem. So moving forward, that it will not count as leverage. So if you include the multifamily lending program, we would not consider that leverage. This will also be included as well in the first FAQ. So in terms of anything related to the property tax abatement or the land donated still nominal price, what we look for is just marketing materials, brochures again, dates of the actual sales, those types of things as confirmation with the letter. So make sure it addresses those points. And the scoring tool covers a lot of these things as well. I believe it is up on the website now. So you'll see a lot of this again verbatim. The half-mile economic investment should look familiar to people in terms of the development characteristics from past years as well. And including the 25% acquired through the county land bank for utilizing the neighborhood initiative program, that is actually the third tiebreaker. So that's something that I would make sure you pay very close attention to as well. The asset building characteristics, I think everyone will hit this, but in terms of the replacement reserves, before we used to not have them in new construction, but we said that single-family infill was new construction. So that became a problem then when we hit year 15 and we're transitioning to home buyers, what exactly would happen to the condition of those properties. So as a way to help get around that or address that issue, which we heard from a lot of people, we have the $2,500 per unit in escrow and matched over 15 years now that you include in your application. So if you were to get funded and you did not include that in that application, at proposal, and we got to final and covering next steps, we would ask that to be addressed, or what was the plan in terms of transitioning to the home buyers. And in regarding the IDA, the important thing to touch upon there is that you make sure that the matched amount is in there and make sure it's a signed letter from the participants. And for the report rent payments to credit bureaus as well, everyone in the ownership structure should sign off that they'll be doing that. For a lot of things here in a development team, experience and capacity, just rent rolls will be perfect for clarifying this in terms of making sure that at least 90% is the average occupancy rate. For the UPCS violations or the 8823s, that's something where we would address it with program compliance to make sure that there isn't anything outstanding. So that's nothing that you would have to do on your end, but we just confirm that on ours. And make sure, too, with the slide that with the disposition, that the final part here with at least 50% eligible units to income qualified buyers over the last 10 years, that's going to be another tiebreaker as well. So that's one of the things you should keep in mind then, that you hit that when filling out your application. And finally, the tiebreakers are listed. And these are the eligible categories that I mentioned previously that you can apply for under a single-family infill. And with that, I will turn it over to scoring and underwriting and Karen.
Clearly, this is a lot of information for folks to absorb, and training obviously is meant to be an overview of the process. I think what you're going to find is both the qualified allocation plan and the competitive review tools that are available are to be used in concert and will be incredibly valuable for you as you start to move forward and plan your meeting should you choose to meet with the OHFA staff. So I'm going to talk a little bit about the process that's going to take place once we receive the applications. Please don't ask me who your analyst is going to be, because the answer is going to be I'm not going to tell you who your analyst is going to be, because I can't tell you how many questions I get in terms of I just want to talk to them so I can see if they need anything. Trust me, if we need something, we'll let you know. The scoring and underwriting, as well as the experience and capacity, are done first in the process. This worked very well last year, and as I predicted, those who were successful, every one of you met threshold, because, you know, we meet threshold, you get the credit. So it worked well, and it saved us a lot of time, because we only had to complete threshold on the applications that were successful. So the competitive workbook, you are required to complete that. If you do not complete that, we cannot score you. I can't stress enough how important it is. And I don't know that anybody's mentioned this yet, but I want to talk a little bit about supporting documentation. Please don't hit us with tons of paper. We don't weigh it and give you competitive points based on weight. I promise you that. You are allowed one, and I hate to call it a cure period for competitive. It's more like a clarification or a redirection period. You get one of those. If you have to spend your time telling us where the information is for that competitive criteria, because we couldn't find it in the 150-plus supporting pages documentation you sent us, you're wasting an opportunity to help us. So you're going to tell us where to find it. We're going to go look for it. And if we still have a question, there's no second shot at that apple. If we still don't believe you meet the criteria, you don't get a second chance to correct that. So it's very important that you highlight information that's relevant. Put notes in. As long as we can read your handwriting, we'll review the notes. Trust me, we'd rather look and get it right the first time so that you can use that competitive clarification period to really direct and answer questions or concerns we might have. So highlight relevant areas. Put notes in the margins, whatever you need to do. The narratives must be completed on the OHFA format when requested. I can't tell you how many times last year we looked at it. Did they use the OHFA format? No? Okay, set it aside. When you're given clear direction like that, we do ask that you follow it, and it does weigh into whether or not we take a look and how quickly and completely we review the material that we've provided. Field visits, just for a minute. Now, once we get the applications, and believe it or not, it takes us some time to get them uploaded, you know, get them assigned, get the maps out, and for Mark and Nigel to identify what their routes are going to be. And we have a limited time to accomplish that. Unfortunately, things happen on the road that Mark and Nigel cannot control. They do try to reach out in advance and let folks know that they're running a little late. But what we ask is that you not bring 15 people to the site visit so you can explain to Nigel and Mark how great your project is, because that slows them up for the next site visit and they can't complete it. They have very limited things that they're looking for, and they're only looking for those items that they're scoring or evaluating. So they need to move quickly. They certainly don't want to miss anything. So if you're there and want to point something out, that's great. But their time is limited on these site visits so that they can move quickly through the process. The competitive workbooks, once we've completed that, as well as the underwriting and the experience and capacity, we're going to send that out to you. And we use the contact names that you provide us in the AFA. If that name's not correct, I don't know what to tell you. So you need to make sure the email address is correct and the contact, who you want us to communicate with, is correct so we can get the information out to you. If you're not signed up for the constant contact, I would strongly recommend you do that, because what we'll say is, hey, development community, we've released our results. If you haven't received it, let me know. Because that's one way to find out that, oops, I didn't get it. I must have had something incorrect in the AFA for you to check and make sure you reach out to us and let us know. We need you to resend that. And here's the correct information. There seemed to be some confusion last year. Underwriting deficiencies absolutely must be addressed. In order for us to make sure we're making smart decisions and selecting the projects that can be successful, we need to make sure that they're financially viable. So we would ask that you, if you have a solution to a problem, let us know. The one answer that's going to cause us a little bit of concern and could be an unfortunate outcome for you is, well, I'll take care of that at final application. There may not be a final application if you do that. So please review that carefully and make sure you respond to us. You might not have a commitment letter, but you've got a plan to address an issue that we've identified that may be a problem for the project. Again, there are no cures, per se, for competitive. It's not an opportunity for you to send in additional information. All you can do at that point in time is direct us to where we can find the information in the documentation you've already submitted to us. That's all I got. I got no more.
So we are running a little bit ahead of schedule. I did want to provide Matt Wooten an opportunity to give you an update on the multifamily lending program, and then we'll have some time for questions and answers, and we'll determine after that time if we want to break early for lunch or if we want to continue to move through the agenda. I'll turn it.
Can you hear me? There we go. My name is Matt Wooten. I'm the manager of the multifamily lending program, and thanks to Kellen for giving me the opportunity to just give you a little commercial about it. It is a permanent financing program for use with affordable housing developments, and it works very well with new allocations of low-income housing tax credits. Currently, we're looking at two deals that are funded in the 2015 round to use this product. Loan terms are typically on this type of deal, 15-year term and 30-year amortization. It's structured as non-recourse debt, and the loans are typically up to $1 million in size, although we can go larger than that with approval from the OHFA board. The rates are typically going to be a 10-year treasury plus 3%, and these rates are locked at the time that underwriting is complete. So this would be after the final application has been received and approved and before you would go to board. So the benefit of that is pretty obvious, is that you have a permanent loan rate that's going to be locked throughout construction. It's something you don't have to worry about. However, one feature that we have included in the new 2016 guidelines is that if for some reason the rate happens to decrease during your construction period, you can relock that rate at a later time prior to closing by paying a $10,000 rate lock reset fee, and it doesn't really take a lot of movement in the rate to achieve that $10,000, so that could be something you want to look at. One thing about this program, that we have very conservative underwriting standards. We do underwrite to the lower of the achievable tax credit rents or the market rents. And so as a result of this, vanilla deals typically work a lot better than projects that have HAP contracts. Typically, you'd be looking at a deal like a senior deal that has very strong rents is going to perform very well with this program. You have strong cap rates, then you're going to be able to borrow the amount of debt that makes sense for your property. Projects that are located in areas with low rents and high cap rates are probably going to struggle a little bit to borrow the amount that they really need to make the deal succeed. If we don't happen to like the cap rate that's in the appraisal, if we don't think it's conservative enough, we might underrate to a higher cap rate too, so we get to a level that we're comfortable with and that the board will approve. So if you have further questions about it, you can feel free to contact me at any time. If you're interested, the 2016 guidelines were approved by the board a couple of months ago, and they're only 5 or 6 pages long, and I really kind of get into the philosophy of how we underwrite each deal. So you can understand going in how we're going to evaluate these properties and what kind of – you can look for yourself to see what kind of loan you'd be in the ballpark to receive. So please contact me for more information. I'd be happy to talk with you. Thank you.
So we've heard a lot of information in just a couple hours here. I'd like to ask if there are any questions that we can address regarding the items that we discussed during our morning agenda. Looks like we have a question in the back. If it's new affordable housing, it could compete one of the new production pools depending on what county it's located in. It cannot have had any rent restriction or subsidy attached to it previously if it's going to be considered as new affordable housing. So this is something we have clarified in the QAP, it's linear distance, and you can calculate that using Google Maps. So it's really the distance between the development and the amenity, the direct distance, the direct linear distance, right? We've gone back and forth in years, so this year we took a step toward clarifying that.
One thing I do want to clarify, we do get scattered site projects, and often we'll say, well, this particular building is within the linear distance for this amenity, and on the other side, this particular building is within linear distance of this amenity. So what you want to do is find the center point of your project, your scattered sites. That's the point we're going to use for linear distance. It's not at any one building. It's the center point of the mix of units or buildings.
We have a question in the far back of the room. That means the city of Akron. And just to repeat the question in case folks didn't hear, this gentleman is asking for local development priority. Would Akron mean Greater Akron, Stark County, or the city? So in this case, we would be looking for local priority from the city of Akron. They would get three or two priorities, family or senior. Not and, yeah. Total, correct. Correct. The city can identify two projects to which they want to provide local priority support. I don't want to necessarily sway you in any one direction, but I would take a look at the competitive workbook. You'll find some additional guidance there. As I mentioned, we are kind of thinking about building performance, sustainability, strategies to enhance safety and security, or other benefits that can be quantified and measured. So as long as you're addressing those, one of the two minimum criteria that are outlined in the QAP and showing some evidence of cost efficiency in one of the four areas I just mentioned, we would consider your narrative.
I can provide one example from a project that was funded last year. There was a significant amount of crime in the area. It had become, I don't want to say, earmarked, or it was stereotyped, it was trademarked as a crime area, and the development process was to redevelop the entire area. They repositioned buildings, worked with the local police department to kind of rebrand the area, give it a whole new look, a whole new feel, so that it would be a deterrent to crime rather than have a history of crime, and their layout and design was incredible. So it wasn't just the buildings, it was the positioning of the buildings, the design of the buildings, everything about the whole layout of the community.
Correct. Yes, later this afternoon, Deborah Lazier will be sharing a little bit about where we are in developing the guidelines for the Section 811 program here in Ohio. I believe what we're looking at is no more than 25% of the units contained in the project would benefit from 811. But again, we'll go into those things in more detail. So for each pool, there is a max credit request that is established. When you see that factor in the tiebreaker, what we are looking for are proposals that are coming in below that max request that's established. So for instance, in family housing, it's $1 million. The farther below you are that $1 million threshold, the better positioned you would be with regard to that scoring or that tie-breaking criteria. It's hard to know without any applications in-house, but
It may not necessarily be, because it'll be different per pool, but if it was $1 million and we had two projects, one had requested 900,000 in credits, which is 100,000 below the cap, and somebody else requested 899,909, they were $101,000 below the cap, the $101,000 is going to rank higher than the other. So it'll be different per pool.
Yes, that's the total credit request. Do we have any other questions from the audience? There's one in the back here. No, you would have to seek those points for which your project is eligible.
Let me give you an example and see if this is what you're talking about. For example, under the senior project or under the senior pool, education opportunity is not an eligible exceptional development. You could not get any points for that, nor could you use it to qualify as a tiebreaker. You may only use those categories for which your pool is eligible for either the points or the tiebreakers. Does that help? Okay.
So the QAP outlines preference consideration, how we're going to give preference consideration to projects for each exceptional development characteristic. And in this case, the QAP specifies that developments that are utilizing a dual approach, so targeting both children and adults, somewhere along the continuum of infants, expecting parents, young children, toddlers, and adults, would be given preference. So to answer your question, it is important if you want highest consideration in education and opportunity to target your strategy to both children and adults.
There was a question from the webinar earlier. The question is, does permanent debt from a private land bank count towards leveraging requirement in the local initiatives criteria under exceptional developments? And the answer is no, permanent debt does not count.
We have another question asking whether local priority letters, if they are a factor in the competitive scoring process for single-family infill. Single-family infill is an urban pool, so it would be eligible for points under local development priority. And we'll try to do a better job of repeating questions as they're posed. My apologies. Are there any other questions? So we are moving pretty fast ahead of our agenda, as I mentioned. Just want to get a quick temperature. Is everyone fine with breaking early for lunch and reconvening at about 12:30 to continue the agenda? Show of hands.
All those in favor, raise your hand.
Okay, so let's move in that direction. We'll meet back here at 12:30. There'll be just a few other things we touch on, and then we'll break for the afternoon, likely far ahead of 5 p.m. So, thank you.
Okay, we're going to go ahead and get started. So we still think we're going to be finishing a little early this afternoon. Just a couple of quick housekeeping things. There are additional handouts in the back if you didn't get one this morning. You can continue to send questions to our 2016 QAP mailbox or fill out one of the cards in the backs and put it in the house back there. So we are going to start with Karen Banyai on design standards and plan review. I'm going to cover construction monitoring requirements. Then we'll have folks from our compliance team go over compliance monitoring requirements, and we'll get into state initiatives and DEVCO and our policy and opportunity mapping. So I think we'll go ahead and get started with Karen. Oh, you want to do questions?
You want us to do the questions real quick?
Yep.
Okay, so we did get a couple of questions in our question box, so we'd like to go over those with you. The first one says, how much prior low-income housing development experience do I need to qualify? Does market-rate housing count? Those of you who have done both market-rate housing or just standard housing development and housing credit development understand the significant difference between the two. The housing credit has a lot of IRS. I don't even know how many forms that have to be completed in that process. So we do expect that somebody on the development team, whether it's the owner or the developer, has experience in developing housing credit projects. And again, both of these have to do with experience and capacity, so I would strongly encourage that if you have a question and you're not quite sure how you fit, that you either follow up with an email or arrange one of those meetings that we had discussed earlier. And the next one is, if I'm a first-time LIHTC developer, can I add a development team consultant to the team, or do I need to have a co-developer? Again, somebody on the development team needs to have experience in developing low-income housing tax credit properties. If you're an owner and you've never done housing credits before, then your developer partner needs to have experience in doing housing credit development. We will not rely on a consultant to meet that requirement. So, again, I'm encouraging you, if you want more specific, if you want to have a one-on-one conversation, we can do that either through email, conference call, or, again, a meeting with the staff so we really understand. But we do expect a member of the ownership and or development team or developer to have experience in doing housing credit development.
We also have two questions here related to exceptional development characteristics. The first concerning economic development. The question here is, would prior market rate development that has happened nearby the development count toward this criterion? As long as it's within the 2-mile required radius, we would consider it in economic development. Where it would not be necessarily considered is community investment. And we can make that distinction clearer in an FAQ if that's helpful. The second question is, could you explain local initiatives as it applies to non-urban counties? So I'll just take a step back. I'll spend just a few moments talking about it, but if there are other questions, please let us know. We can provide additional clarification. So developments in the family, senior, and non-urban pools can seek these points for local initiatives. Recall that local initiatives provides the benefit of a 2-year allocation. So in the case of non-urban counties, the development would need to be recognized as contributing to a community, economic, or neighborhood plan. The development must provide a mix of land uses and housing types, including market rate housing. It must include a minimum of 50 units in non-urban counties. And it must receive a letter of local support from the municipality in which the project will be located. Additionally, we do expect that the project will leverage significant economic leverage through partnership with public and private organizations. This might include local foundations, corporations, or other institutions that are providing resources accounting for no less than 25% of total development cost. So I hope that clarifies how we'll look at local initiatives in the non-urban pool. And the QAP does specify that a maximum of one development in the family, senior, and non-urban pools may be awarded under local initiatives. So there will be one project potentially in a non-urban county that receives the benefit of this this point category.
So we're going to talk a little bit about design standards and the plan review process that happens during the competitive round. Not much has changed in this, but there are a few points that I do want to bring up. The key word that we look at is durable. So while the QAP may not have a design standard specific to the issue you're considering, the question we're going to have is it durable?
We're not looking at 15 years. We're looking at the maximum amount of time available that that product is durable for or warrantied for. You're working with your syndicator for a 15-year period. We're looking at this project as a 30-year development. So while we do know that some things will need to be maintained or replaced during the course of that time frame, we're looking for the most durable material financially and economically available to that project. Now, there are certain requirements within the QAP. If it's not required in the QAP, the only question you'll have to answer is it the most durable product that this project can provide for its residents? Mark Schlutz, if you don't know who Mark is, Mark in the back there, is the architect who reviews this. He will often offer suggestions about the project. If it's not specified in the QAP, you are not required to do it. However, we will require you to address the durability issue. How durable is that? Is it the most durable product available for that particular project type population being served? The plan review, when the plans are reviewed during the competitive process, they're reviewed to make sure they meet the minimum design requirements. Understand we have 100 projects, usually, sometimes more, and Mark is also doing site visits. So he's looking for the minimum amount of information required. Once selected the project, he does a much more thorough review and provides you with feedback on that review. So there may be additional questions during your next steps meetings, things we want you to consider as you move forward. But there's always the possibility that when you're looking at a number of applications, something could get missed. You're still required to comply with the qualified allocation plan. Oh, and Mark is often, we're often asked, how do I submit this? What format do you want to see this? Do you want a hard copy? It's detailed in the qualified allocation plan exactly what we want to see from you. That's a threshold requirement. You are going to have to meet that. So please pay particular attention because it's not just a digital copy. It's also a hard copy, and there are very specific requirements that you must meet in the format that it has to be presented. Green standards. We went through yesterday three of the two of them. There are actually three standards available, the LEED, the Enterprise Green, and the National Green Buildings Standards, NGBS. That you may choose from. You are required to have a certification from that entity, whichever one you select, at the issuance of your 8609. Now, during the process, you can actually apply to any one of those entities for an exception request to one of their requirements. And if they say no, you can certainly ask OHFA to advocate on your behalf to whatever entity you're working with. If we believe it's something we can support and it's appropriate for the project, Mark has had very good success in managing that process with Enterprise. They may place other requirements so you can achieve the same standard, but he's very good at negotiating that. Once, if he supports the decision you're making or the request, if he doesn't, he will not advocate on your behalf. We won't grant exceptions to a waiver. We will advocate for you. At the end of the day, when you do your 8609, you will have to have a certification for whichever standard you've elected. So, while we'll help you when we believe it's appropriate, we can't guarantee an outcome. And if you're doing multiple buildings, you do need a separate architect certification for each building. Pay particular attention to the square footage. That's one of the most challenging things we look at, and we are still doing the two standard deviations to identify those projects which should be removed from competition because they're outside of the norm. So your square footage is critical in that evaluation. You don't want to be, I guess, penalized or singled out because there was an error in the way you calculated square footage. Mark is available to answer questions on that. And if you have a building that has an alternate or a different use, you've got commercial space in the building and you're not sure how to represent that in your pro forma or your architect certification, please reach out to us. We can help you with those. We'd hate for you to get to the application, submit something that we haven't got a clue what you're trying to tell us, when it can be easily corrected in a conversation prior to the submission of the application and the various certifications required. Okay, that's all I have. If there are no questions, I'm just going to go sit down and I'm done for the day.
Uh,
All right. So I'll be very brief on construction monitoring because I know Karen touched on what Nigel and Mark will do in preparation for your applications. So this is more once you've been awarded. So our construction monitoring team does site visits. We do quarterly construction monitoring reports and closeout visits. And this is to help ease the transition of your project from our office to the Office of Program Compliance with a final closeout meeting and then subsequent submission of 8609s later on. So we have project administration staff. We have one field staff person. That's Nigel Simpson. We have two project administration analysts slash construction closeout coordinators. Those are Sally Mitchell and Jim Evans. We typically have between 300 and 400 active projects in the construction phase. And so, again, our staff does those site visits, processes draw requests for HDAP funded projects, and processes requests for Forms 8609. On the site visit front, post-award, we ask that you invite our staff to a pre-construction meeting if you're planning to have one. I know with some funding sources, you don't always have one. So if you don't have one, we want you to notify our project administration staff that construction is commencing. The majority of site visits will occur once construction is started. Staff will notify your development team of the site visit and typically meet with the superintendent or staff on site at the time. Our staff will take photos of construction progress and check for spot check items in the scope of work and the design and construction features agreement and ER mitigations that may already be underway. This is a new process started in under the 2015 QAP, but also in the 2016-17 QAP, we require quarterly construction monitoring reports. These are required the first period following either board approval or announcement of award. So for 9% projects, that would be the period following awards, and for HDEP projects, it would be after you've gone through the board approval process. We ask for some basic information about the construction process and milestones. We ask for photographs and a description of what's happened since the previous period. These include things like site prep, grading, foundation trenches, footing, wall insulation, utility rough-ins, et cetera. You know, some indication of that these things are progressing. And those reports, again, are due quarterly. And that's pretty much it for me. So we have gotten some questions about whether or not folks can submit construction monitoring reports that are filed with your syndicator if they're performing those. We'd be happy to accept those, but we still want you to fill out our form just so it's consistent across the board that we're getting those. But again, we're not trying to create duplicative work. If you've already taken photos, if you've already submitted information that's included on another report, submit it along with ours, and we'll make sure we get that information. So I will leave it there.
Today with us from the Office of Program Compliance, we have Betsy Krieger, who is the Director of Program Compliance, and Christine Bennett, who is our Compliance Training and Operations Manager. Also, here in the front row, if you guys could wave, we have Tanya Bruner, who is a Compliance Manager in Program Compliance, and Rachel Grass, who is also a Manager in our Program Compliance Office. So they're just going to share a little bit this afternoon about some of the updates to our compliance monitoring requirements that you may or may not have seen in the 2016-2017 QAP update.
Hey, good afternoon, everyone. It's good to be with you here today on this bright, sunny day, and here we are inside. But I know that you are learning a lot, so... Certainly, I want to introduce the rest of the compliance team that is here with us today. Rachel Grass, if you guys would stand up. And Rachel Grass is our policy and technology manager. She's been really key on, as far as DevCo is concerned, helping the industry as well as our staff. And then we have Tanya Bruner, who is a compliance manager. She has recently joined our office. She's been with us now for a couple of months, and so we're very blessed to have her on board with us. Jeremy Myers was unable to be with us. He is our senior asset manager, and we are right now trying to build that office. It had been vacant for some time with the departure of Jim Bauman, so look for good things from him. And then also Todd Carmichael, which I'm sure many of you who know is our other compliance manager. So Christy and I are going to kind of tag team and talk about some compliance issues, as well as the home rule changes and then also extended monitoring requirements that we've had a substantial policy change on that. And as Callan had mentioned, there are handouts in the back. I would encourage you. There is a compliance handout. I certainly would encourage you to take one of those. It does include contact information of the compliance team. So I'll turn it over to Christine.
Hey, thanks. Couple of things. Now, if you will all take your compliance, your QAPs out, brought them today, right? Okay, those of you that didn't, I'm seeing some arms. I'm joking. Not really. For those of you that don't know me, I'm a stickler for detail. That's why we're in compliance, because you know we get to hear. And I understand we have until 5 o'clock today, so that means that we can actually go into an in-depth discussion about the QAP and about compliance that goes with it. Actually, that being said, there are some things that you all do need to know about that will happen during the development phase as it transitions over into compliance, and then also some things that carry over even after the property service that you all will still need to know about. So one of the things is making sure that the property itself is entered into our Ohio Housing Locator. That's the current website that we're using for folks that are looking for affordable housing, clearinghouse of knowledge. It's a requirement that your property is entered into that. But also, for those of you that may have also developed other properties, make sure that that gets updated regularly. You're finding that some folks met that minimum requirement and they've never touched it. So the information that's out there is woefully outdated. In the compliance trainings, I often tell people to shop their own property, ask themselves if they would want to live there, how it looks and how it portrays itself in the location. Some other things that you need to understand about program compliance part is there are actually three things that happen with when a property is transitioning into being placed into service. And one of those things is that someone who has decision-making authority files attends the compliance training within 6 months of service. Karen mentioned this earlier this morning about folks that are kind of new to us that we will ask you to come to at least one and maybe a couple of times. And on the development side, that you all understand some of the things that have to happen once it does transition. So we have not set our 2016 training schedule yet, but we will be traveling the state. So we'll be compliance trainings in Columbus area, obviously, but also in Cleveland, Cincinnati, Toledo, add some other venue. Well, also a couple of other things is that there is a requirement for a placed in service meeting. That meeting should happen around that same time. A lot of these things are going to happen about the same time. So when you're doing your pre-leasing activities or when you're doing your qualification that you place into service, this is the ideal time to make sure that it happens. That is to have a place in service meeting with our staff, find your project. We look at portfolios every single year and make those assignments. So our staff of all have their own portfolio. Some of them are based on geography. We have six folks that are actually outstations, and they actually are stationed homes. And their territories usually are within a little radius of their domicile. So the other thing that has to happen then is that 15 days of placing the last building at the project in service, notify us in writing that's happened. That's saying it is a go, then allow the analyst to get you on their calendars because we have certain requirements where we have to come out and do the project. Then 2 years after you service, same year in place in service, you'll definitely have to. Something else I want to mention, and Betsy is probably going to go into more detail about this, comments that she has, but there is a requirement. If you have a company, So if the company that is going to be managing the property is not part of the ownership entity of the property, you have to have a valid Ohio broker's license. That is Department of Requirement. We have found that we have had some partners that have not broker's license in another state. That doesn't mean it works for Ohio. There are some lines of reciprocity, but they do not match. We've actually had some management companies that have either had to be part of the management or the ownership team, rather, or they've had to find someone with which they could broker Ohio a broker's license. To make sure that that's the try before you buy, have that. Hire them if they need to have a action to get that. And it's not, from my understanding, it's not a simple one-shot deal, takes one day to get. Actually, there are several courses you need. Another thing is to make sure that the property is registered into DEVCO, which is our online report. While you all will be doing your application on in part of DEVCO, there's the whole other piece of DEVCO, and that's the so make sure that that happens. Once you start qualifying households, have DEVCO set up that so you can enter your tenant data into that. We have a lot more information about DEVCO on our website, a guide of how to, and a webinar that we will actually be expanding in right now, but it's going to be last but certainly not least, what I'm going to talk about the QAP, before I switch over to some of the home stuff, is changes. Changes in ownership, changes in management company. They have to have prior approval, have to be by us. We have to be notified within 60 days ahead of this. We are finding, unfortunately, that there are a lot of changes. We get surprised by this on the annual owner report. That's actually been a QAP requirement for a number of years. So we may end up having to do some further enforcement or reinforcement of those rules. That's where we get to play good cop, bad cop. I'd rather be the good cop right now and tell you you need to know it. It's in the queue. Like to have to be the bad cop and say you've been bad and this could affect your ability to get future funding from. We all love our funding, or else you wouldn't be here. So I'm going to switch gears really quickly and go over to some of the home changes, and this actually pertains to those projects that received credits in 2015 as well as anticipated for 2016. And then also there are some of the rules that apply to all home projects. And Home published their new final home rule in 2013. There were several things that affected. Some of those things had a staggered implementation date. One of the things that's going to affect you most, and this is something that's new, so I'm going to talk about the new first, and then we'll go into something that affects all of us. And that has to do with utility allowances. What the home rule says, if you have home funding through us or through any entity, that we have to approve your utility allowance. Utility allowance cannot have a PHA utility allowance as a source document. So this is actually going to be based on pure consumption data or estimates, the HUD utility model, that sort of thing, not rely on the PHA. That was a determination by the folks at Home in Washington. A couple of other things that would be affected then to all of us, and that's the main thing. We have to look at rents every year. When the home rents come out, we'll create a form. At that time, any recipient of home funds will need to complete it to, in essence, ensure their compliance with the new updated home limits to ensure that you will not be charging over those home rent limits for that period. That's a requirement of any program property that has received student rule. The home program now has to abide by the HUD student. So there are definite definitions about that, way different than the tax credit student rule, not to be confused with the tax credit student rule, and not to be morphed into a third rule that we see often. I find that folks kind of take some of the HUD student rule, the tax credit student rule, and they come up with their new own variety that doesn't work for either of the programs. So understand what those are as well, and we've got more information about that on our website if you're interested in the home program. They're telling me I'm not talking loud enough. I have never been told I'm not talking loud enough. For those of you on the webinar, we will be doing, no, we won't be doing it again. I'm sorry about that, but hopefully we'll be loud enough moving forward.
couple of other things. For all of our home properties, we have to do a risk assessment. The risk assessment is what determines the frequency of our reviews. So home has now, in the past, it was either a 1, 2, or 3-year cycle, basically determined by the size of your property. When the new home rule was published, it actually established this need and chance for us to develop a risk assessment that would define how often we would come out, either on a 1, 2, or 3-year cycle. So we did baseline risk assessments for any properties that we had already in the works. And then after every review that we do at that property, we will do a follow-up risk assessment to see what the next schedule will be. So that's about it as far as the home front, but I wanted you all to hear it because I know that so many times we have both tax credits and home funds at our properties, and we need to understand the dance that, that the two programs have to play together. So thank you.
Thanks, Christine. So we have, as I mentioned earlier, a substantial policy change on extended use properties. Now, these are the properties that have entered the second 15-year. Remember, the first 15-year, excuse me, is the compliance period. So this is the second 15-year phase of the project. And what we've been seeing is a pretty substantial uptick in properties that are in even year 12, 13, 14, and especially those that are already in extended use that certainly are starting to struggle financially. There's a lack of money to turn the units, high vacancy rate perhaps. And so we felt as a responsibility, obviously, that we needed to start on-site monitoring. Now, for years, our policy has been that we do a paper monitoring, meaning we collect the annual owner certification and tenant data. We will continue to do that. That policy has not changed. However, the tenant data now we will be requiring for all tenants. We did in the past just require for new move-ins, but we certainly wanted to get the full picture of all the residents that were living in the property. So starting January 1st of this next year, our policy, as I mentioned, has changed that we will start doing on-site monitoring. Our compliance analysts are filling out an assessment tool right now to determine the cycle in which the project will be reviewed, whether it be either a 3- or 5-year cycle. They are looking at the tool itself is a scoring tool, looking at vacancy rates, whether or not there's 8823s, and that's a form that's issued to the IRS for compliance or noncompliance, and looking at economic vacancies, things like that. And depending upon then where the project scores, it will either be reviewed on a 3- or 5-year cycle. Now, the caveat to that is we have about 70-plus properties that have not had a review, on-site review, in 5 or more years. And so those have been prioritized. All of those properties will be reviewed this next year. And so, as I mentioned, the compliance analysts are busy filling that tool out for each of their properties. As Christine had mentioned, each of them, they do have their own portfolio ranging anywhere from 95 to about 132 properties apiece. And also they will be, for those properties that are entering extended use at the end of this year, we are going to be sending a notification to them just as a reminder of what our new policy is and what the requirements are. I've also, for those owners that are in extended use, we have sent direct mail to them as far as outlining this new policy and the requirements that they are required to maintain. So analysts, once they are on site, they're going to be looking at 10% of the files, 10% of the units, and 100% of the buildings. Now, obviously, if they are identifying compliance issues, patterns of noncompliance, they certainly are going to be doing more units and more files. The process will be the same as far as the first 15 years, that the analysts will write a written report, send that out to the owner. The owner will be placed into a 60-day correction period for any deficiencies that were noted, whether it be smoke detectors or there's some issues with the resident files. So that owner will have 60 days then to submit a response back, indicating and verifying that the corrections have been made.
Now, the only thing that we, unfortunately, with projects in extended use, we don't have necessarily as many enforcement tools. Basically, as I mentioned before, the 8823, which is the notice of noncompliance to the IRS, they do not want to see those for projects that have entered extended use. So we are, Lynn, left with a couple of tools, neither of which we'd like to use. We could place an owner on our watch list if that owner fails to respond to our review or simply fails to correct the deficiencies. Right now we have about 11 properties that are on that watch list, and it's basically just a red flag property list of, you know, of projects that are struggling for one reason or another, whether it be vacancy, financial issues. Certainly in certain cases, I mentioned our asset management office will get involved to help perhaps structure a workout plan to help them become more financially viable. So certainly that would be one option. And then the second option, our tool that we have, and we really don't like to use this, but we've had to do it in the past, is to place the owner as not in good partnership. And certainly once that happens, then the owner has the inability to access any program funding, tax credits, or gap financing. But certainly we never like to go that route. You know, we certainly, compliance, we play a dual role. We certainly not are, you know, we're not only regulating when we go on site, but also we're educating. You know, we are your partner. And certainly we want to work with you for those who do have existing properties and those perhaps that may be awarded in 2016 or 17. Certainly we go out of our way, or at least try to work with you and make sure that you do stay compliant. So that's it for the extended use properties. Certainly we are going to have more that will be coming out. More will be posted on our website in the next several months. And certainly we'd be happy to take any questions if you have any.
Actually, I want to jump in real quick talking about extended use, Betsy. For those of you, since we do have the development crowd in the room, in extended use, our policy has been, because just to back up, the IRS said you have to have an extended use policy. They gave us some ideas of how long it should be, but it was up to us to not only define the time period, but also define the rules. In our current extended use policy, we do relax things like the student rule and the available unit rule. However, new people coming in have to qualify. If you are working with a property and thinking about doing a re-syndication of credits in order for those current residents to grandfather in and still be qualified, you need to make sure that the owner has been complying with the student rule to ensure that those units will still grandfather in, that you won't use the ability to claim those units. Also, the other thing to know, and this is something that as we've been setting up DevCo and we've been working with PP&D to work on this, some of these very old projects, so that were funded, say, back in like the late 80s, early 90s, before the IRS had the requirement for an extended use policy, there were some that had absolutely no extended use. And then in the very early days, we had some that had maybe a 5-year extended use or a 10-year extended use. If your project had fulfilled all of that and they no longer had to comply with those rules, there's a difference between a reallocation and a re-syndication, and so you may have lost the ability to claim those in-place residents as grandfathering in, because if you had ceased to comply with doing the rules that you needed to do. So just bear that in mind when you're doing your due diligence on that side, as you're looking at things that could be possible risk factors with qualified tenants.
Thanks for mentioning that. Are there any questions? And you know, one last thing I do want to mention, I'm sure probably most of you are already enrolled in it, but we do have an email subscribe. Certainly you can subscribe right and get submitted on that, and it is an icon on our webpage. It takes about a minute or two to complete. Basically, you can customize it, whether you want to receive notifications just from the PP&D office or whether you'd like to receive notifications also from the compliance office as far as when regulations change or we have policy changes. So it's a really good tool to take advantage of, and it's very, very easy to sign up and free. So certainly it is a good tool for you to have.
Okay.
thank you, Betsy, and your team for coming and providing updates on what's going on in program compliance. Just in the interest of everyone's time, we're going to continue to plow through the afternoon agenda. So up next, we have Deborah Leisure and Jeanette Welch from the Ohio Department of Medicaid. They're going to speak a little bit about state initiatives, including the Section 811 program and the 18% rental subsidy pilot that is being supported under the next two-year allocation plan.
I'd like to tell you about a new program that OHFA is administering starting hopefully in the beginning of next year. It's a rental assistance, a project-based rental assistance program called the Ohio 811 Project Rental Assistance Program. And what this is a $12 million grant that we have received from HUD. We were the second largest allocation in the country, and it's a rather ambitious program. We hope to assist 485 units with that $12 million. This grant is actually a collaboration between OHFA and the Ohio Department of Medicaid, along with the Ohio Department of Developmental Disabilities and the Ohio Department of Mental Health and Addiction Services. The role of OHFA in this partnership is to help select the properties that will be available and to also administer the actual rental assistance money to the developments. And the Department of Medicaid will be responsible for ensuring the eligibility of potential tenants and also matching them with available units. And the way that this is intended to work is that you as developers will set aside up to 25% of the units in a property for this program, and then Medicaid will then help refer people to your developments as vacancies become available. I'm going to go on to just describe the eligible properties a little bit more for you. This is available to tax credit properties only, and they can either be new properties coming up under the 2016-17 QAP or existing properties. And they have to have at least five or more units, which is a given. And again, up to 25% of the properties are eligible. And the total amount of properties that you can have set aside for people with disabilities, whether or not they are subsidized, is 25%. The idea is to have an integrated setting for people with disabilities. It's not just one development of people with disabilities. And any of the units that receive other rental assistance are not eligible for this assistance, and properties that have people age restrictions for people over 62 are also not eligible. The eligible households need to be 18. The person with disability has to be 18 to 62 years old at the time of admission, not necessarily at the time of tenancy, continued tenancy. So this is designed for households that are at 30% or less of the area median income, and at least one person in the household is disabled and is 18 to 62 years old. And also the person who will be the potential tenant will need to be covered under community-based long-term care services and supports through Medicaid, through the waiver program, and also any of the board services that will also be referring to the program. In our application, we were awarded the $12 million based on a certain geographical location of the units available. So 60% of the units will be targeted to the 8 urban areas in the state, and we've also allowed for preferences for units in Franklin, Portage, and Wayne counties. They have committed to supplying housing vouchers in addition to these subsidies in units in these counties. It's a limited number, but still it will provide a preference for those counties. And as far as ownership capacity, we're looking for owners who have experience working with these programs. Could be Section 8, you know, federal programs with rental assistance, which will help your previous experience will help in the reporting programs and also will help in just being able to know how to administer programs with people under subsidy. And if you have a former, you have ability to work with subsidized programs in the past and social service programs. That's really just a brief overview, and I'm sure it may have sparked some questions in your mind. If you'd like to present any questions now, I'd be happy to answer them.
Debbie, if I could add to that just a couple of things. We're kind of all in the weeds in this per se right now. We are obviously working diligently with our partners, Ohio Department of Medicaid specifically, and many other agencies to get the application together and all the referral processes. We certainly are in touch with other state housing agencies that were awarded funding during the first round. This obviously was the second round, $150 million from HUD that's expected to help about 4,600 units across the country. We anticipate probably anywhere from about 500 that will be assisted with our money that we've received from HUD. We've had several webinars with HUD right now. And we still, unfortunately, are waiting for an agreement with HUD. It was, you know, one thing that during the first couple webinars that we had with them, certainly they were saying, you know, oh, we've had lessons learned, and we're going to move much more quickly on this and more efficient, and so here we are still waiting and waiting. It's expected that we'll have a signed agreement next month. I know several from our office are going to be going to a convening in D.C. this next month. All of the state housing agencies that were awarded for this second round of funding will be there. So I'm sure at that point in time we will receive much more information to give to the industry, and much will be posted on our website, and I'm sure in the next several months to come. So it is, it's a 20-year program. However, it's only funded for 5. Congress would have to reappropriate money for that. So.
Two questions. I guess, Debbie, I heard you say that we could set aside up to 25% of the units. And earlier, I think my question was just for the 5 points for state initiatives, do we have to set aside 25%, or could you set aside 15% and still get those points?
Yes, there's nothing in the QAP that would not allow that. So we would consider it at this point.
We had talked about maybe a minimum floor, but certainly we never made that standard. So certainly, that certainly would be allowed.
Okay, and then is there any guidance available on how to set rents if, like, I don't know if the HUD 811 program goes by MR or?
We're actually waiting for all that information. It will be in our cooperative agreement. Once we actually see that, we'll have further information on that, and we'll let you folks know. Also, there is a dedicated section on the OHFA website for the 811 program, so you may want to kind of keep in touch with that. We'll also keep in contact with you through constant contact with any information that we get and guidance that we get in the future.
Could you just explain the additional preferences for those 3 counties and Section 8 voucher matching agreements?
Those 3 counties, the MHAs in those counties have set aside a certain amount of Section 8 vouchers that will also go along with the development in addition to the subsidy from the 811 program. You can have 100% of your building getting 811, obviously, and but you can have other subsidies in the development. A unit that is covered by 811 can only have 811 subsidy. No, they're additional Section 8 housing vouchers that have been promised to those buildings that are taking advantage of the 811 program. You just can't combine it in one unit. You can only have that subsidy in that unit.
If I can jump in, you can't have project-based assistance at the entire property. But if you have an 8, you can have, like, I'll give an example of a 236 project where you might have project-based assistance on some but not all of the units. So as long as the 811 units were those other units not covered under the HAP contract, those could use the 811 monies. And then with the Section 8 voucher, that was part of the application process that we had to partner and get those promises. So I know it's confusing, and I know that, like Betsy says and Deva said, a lot of these things, we're still waiting on HUD to give us some final guidelines. We hope to know more absolutely after this convening that's supposed to happen next month.
Not necessarily. I think it's at their discretion as to how many they want to award to each development. They have a total number for the county. Well, we hope you'll keep in touch, and we'll follow up with you folks. And also, there is an advisory committee that has had one meeting so far to help us guide in mapping out this program, and we may be asking for additional assistance and attendance. So we may be calling on you folks to join our committee also.
My name's Jeanette Welsh, and I'm with the Ohio Department of Medicaid, and I'm here to talk with you a little bit about a very similar initiative. And it is similar in that it also will provide subsidy, however, it's with Medicaid money. The target audience is very low-income people who need accessible housing. And a lot of those people will be on Supplemental Security Income, or SSI. That's how the project gets its name, in that people who are on SSI are living at the 18% of AMI. We've projected that the amount of money that we have available will provide us with about 35 to 40 subsidies statewide. The initiative is going to be in the new unit production policy pool. And like 811, the priority population for the program will be individuals who are exiting an institution on Medicaid's home choice program. These are individuals who have lived in a facility setting for at least 90 days and are going to be receiving services either through the Ohio Department of Medicaid, Mental Health and Addiction Services, Department of Developmental Disabilities, and Ohio Department of Aging. We're really still working on a lot of the details with this. We're trying to make this initiative fit and really kind of complement or augment what 811 is doing. Like 811, we want to achieve that integrated setting for people who have a disability to ensure that really we're kind of complying with some of the guidance that came out of the Olmstead decision. Medicaid will be in the seat where we'll be overseeing the referral process to projects who receive the subsidies. I'm told right now that the best way that we'll be able to communicate with you moving forward is going to be through the constant contact list. I thoroughly expect that we will be doing a webinar that's going to have a little bit more information on the specifics of the project. I could share with you right now that we're looking at 1 to 2 bedroom units. Obviously, I said it was already new construction. And there won't be any age restriction on this particular subsidy. So I think, again, there's a lot of overlaps between what is being done in 811 and what we'll be doing. We're looking to try to meet this out so that it has something that is a little different. And the main thing, of course, is being that our money goes for 15 years. I don't know if I said that. So with as much as I can today, I can answer your questions. There's still quite a bit up in the air right now.
And as both of our state initiatives presenters have indicated, we'll be hosting a webinar for both 811, I understand that's in the works, as well as the 18% pilot in the future months. So please just stay tuned for that as we work out and try to work through some of the details on these subsidy programs. But if there are any questions, we'll happy to jot those down. I know, Amy, you had a question, and we'll follow up with some concrete examples on how 811 will interact with the housing choice vouchers in the three preference counties. But if there are other things that we can clarify in future technical assistance releases, please let us know so that we can air thoughtful responses. And if there aren't any questions, I'd like to turn it over to Kevin, who's going to talk about DevCo and how we'll be moving forward with this interactive tool. And then there'll be one more thing on our agenda before we adjourn for the day.
Good afternoon, everyone. Can everyone hear me okay? Because unlike some folks, I speak very softly. I want to make sure that I get my message out to you. My position within the agency is the portfolio manager, so that means I'm working with existing OHFA properties and data, and for that reason, I am part of the various DevCo teams that we have in-house that go across different offices within our agency. And this includes the online application that we introduced last year. Now, the main thing that I'm here to tell you is that we are once again going to be requiring the online application at the proposal stage. And we also plan to use this for the final application in 2016. We are going to have the online application ready to go and open for you by January the 15th. And then, as Karen had mentioned this morning, we're going to give some additional time for this piece of the application. And you'll have up to 2 weeks after the other proposal materials are due. So the online application will need to be entered into our system no later than March 3rd. Now, we do have the application ready. The interface from last year is going to look very much the same as it did last year. We are working on some changes to it. But the biggest change really is behind the scenes. Over the summer, we moved the administration of DevCo from a third-party contractor to our in-house IT department. So I think that is going to give us some more flexibility in the areas of timing and communication. I can go right upstairs and see our IT folks and work with them on any issues that we might be having. So we are currently working with their department to both prioritize and make revisions to the application. That will hopefully improve on this and make this a better experience for you. Now, as was the case last year, all of the members of the development team will need to be registered within the system. This will need to be done in order to complete the application, and this also helps us with having accurate information in our database about all of our partners, things like addresses, telephone numbers, contact information, and the like. We'll be having a registration form, and we will be making this available. We're going to be posting this up onto the 2016 QAP page on our website. It'll look similar to what we had last year. Now, with the registration form, we'll want you to complete and submit one form for each development team member that'll be on your project, and we'll need those for any organizations that did not register last year. And as well, you can use the form to submit updated information on any organizations who we already have in our system. If you're not sure whether an organization has been registered or not, then go ahead and complete and submit a form to us. And there are a number of things that we'll want to get on those registration forms. One is organization information that includes things like the address, parent organizations, and what type of organization it is. We'll want to know what the roles of the organization are. Is this organization a developer? Are they a management company? Do they serve multiple roles? You'll be able to check more than one box for each organization. We'll want to know who the contact persons are for that organization, both the primary contact as well as other contacts. And then what is their role within the organization? There's a drop-down list on that registration form, and you'll want to choose whatever the best selection is from that list. The completed registration forms, you can submit those to the DevCo application email box, and the address is on the screen. We do ask that you allow our staff up to 2 weeks to enter the information and to notify you that it's been completed, and to also send the organization codes that will be used to link organizations together so that they can be included in your application. We do ask that you send all those forms to us no later than the 4th of February. This will give us at least that 2 week period of time to do our part, and then we'll give you time to get your application completed by the beginning of March. If you do forget this stuff or you miss this step and you don't get things in by February 4th, we'll take them later, but we ask you to submit those as soon as you possibly can so we can help you meet your deadline to get the application completed. And then one of my responsibilities in this process will be to update the reference guide that we had last year with any changes that end up being made. And we'll be making that available when the online application is opened in January. And as well, you can always feel free to contact Kellen Craig or myself with any questions or if you need assistance. We understand this can be a little bit complex. Last year was the first time going through it all for us, and if there's anything that you ever, any questions, comments, we're happy to speak with you about that. And are there any questions at this time? Yes. It's going to look very much the same as it did last year. We may be making some changes to the application based on comments that we got last year, also based on the amount of time that we have to make those changes. One of the things we're doing now is prioritizing what are the things that we can get done the quickest. And there may be some other things that we want to do, but due to the nature of the program, might be too complex to get done in the next few months. So we're just going to try to make this, we're going to try to improve it. I don't have anything in terms of anything that I can show you at this point. But we are working on that. Okay, thanks for your attention, and I believe we have one more presentation this afternoon.
So this is less of a presentation and more of a demonstration. Concerning our opportunity maps and our policy mapping tool that are available on our OHFA website. As many of you may know who were involved in developing the QAP, OHFA partnered with the Kerwin Institute for the Study of Race and Ethnicity at The Ohio State University to map opportunity as sort of derived from an index that encompasses a number of indicators in the areas of education, job access and mobility, environmental hazards. And what this helps us get at is the comprehensive opportunity level of a particular census tract as related to the actual site, proposed site of new family housing developments. So we were anticipating during our planning process release of the disparate impact Supreme Court ruling, as well as the affirmatively furthering fair housing rule. So this was a step that we took to get ahead of those issues. And this is a pilot initiative. We're just sort of trying to think more strategically about how we allocate under this QAP resources to support affordable housing development for families. So the opportunity maps are located on our website. And I will show you a little bit about how these maps function. It's important to note in both cases with the opportunity maps and the policy maps, both mapping tools function a little bit more better in Chrome or Firefox. We haven't had as good luck with Explorer, so that's just a note for your future use. And I'm just going to show you essentially now how these function. With the opportunity mapping tool, these maps are available for the 6 largest counties in Ohio, and the map displays areas from low to high opportunity. So higher opportunity areas are indicated in red and orange, and lower, of course, lower opportunity areas are indicated in yellow or lighter shading. So if you click on a census tract, what it will provide to you is a breakout of all of the data and indicators that went into determining the comprehensive opportunity level. It'll provide you with the census tract ID, show you a breakout of each indicator and how this track scores in that area. And once you get to the bottom, it will give you a comprehensive opportunity level. Keep in mind that the QAP does incentivize moderate to high, so it's important to look for that. But if you look at the bottom of each of these little windows, you can understand where and which of the 3 areas I mentioned your particular census tract is demonstrating more strength. So for instance, with this particular tract, education and opportunity level is 4, job access and mobility is 1, and environmental hazard is 3. When all of those items are considered together, the comprehensive opportunity level is very high. So that's just a little bit about how to use the opportunity mapping tool. I will say we regrettably are having some difficulty with the address search function, and we're working with Esri, who is the developer of this mapping tool, to resolve that. But the pan and zoom functions of the tool still work. For the policy mapping tool, just to do a quick demonstration, I'm going to utilize OHFA's street address to show you how to analyze scoring data by county and census tract. So as you can see here, I've entered our office location. I'm going to hit search. The tool will return a window that shows the location of the address as indicated by this orange triangle here. Depending on what data indicator I'm looking to assess for. You'll select it from either the county level indicators or the census tract level indicators. For the purposes of this example, I'll just select households with one or more housing problems by county. If you select that, it'll pull up that particular indicator and shade the map accordingly. So you can see here that this site is positioned in a county that is at least 31.52 or more percent where you have households experiencing one or more housing problems. Now, we've had a lot of questions as to whether these breakouts pertain to the scoring in the QAP, and they do not. So it's important to pay attention to the next steps that I'm going to walk you through. I'm going to hide the legend just for purposes of display here. But you'll want to click just outside of your orange triangle to see which data layers, indicators are going to be eligible for the various criteria. So in this case, households with one or more housing problems in this county are 35.71%. It'll also show you the other criteria that are available at the county level. So this county is showing net new stable job growth. There are no permitted drilling wells in this county. It's also showing 5.6% job growth, and the share of the population age 55 and older was 20.96%. It'll also tell you that this is not an underserved rural county. You can do the same for census tract level data. It'll function exactly the same. I can see if it's in a high income census tract. Again, if I show the legend, you'll see here that it's not in a high income census tract since it's shaded in orange or yellow. And if you click again right outside of the orange triangle, it'll show you which criteria for census tract level data the site will meet. So again, this is not a high income census tract. However, there are more than 60% of households earning $40,000 or less, and there are 45.47% of jobs that pay $40,000 or less. So that is just a quick run through of how the mapping tools work. I know we'll continue to receive a lot of questions, and again, we'll work to resolve the address search function with the opportunity map, but I'm happy to help you troubleshoot on a case-by-case basis as you're utilizing these tools. I know this is kind of a new thing for our allocation process, but the intent with these is really to assist you all. So I hope that at the end of the day that it provides some assistance as you're preparing applications. Are there any questions that I can answer or different steps that I can go over again? No? All right. Well, I don't know if they're from any of the other panelists, if there are final remarks. But I'd just like to reiterate our thanks for you coming out, spending a good portion of your day with us to learn about our programs and our requirements. I would remind you all that we will be issuing our second frequently asked question edition on September 30th. We'll address many of the questions that were raised today, as well as those that come in prior to that time. If you think of anything else, feel free to reach out to us. We're here and we're willing and able to answer your questions. And I would also encourage you to take advantage of the pre-proposal meeting. Of course, following the guidance provided by Kellen and Karen as to how those meetings should function. And I guess we're done for the day. So thank you all.